Suppose that you are a provider, telephony provider. I'm sorry for the small print there. I think Keynote has punished me for using PowerPoint. So you have customers, okay? Maybe about 11 million Greek customers and about 25 million of visitors that come to Greece every year. And you suspect that your competition steals your customers and you want to do something about it. So what can you do about that? Okay, this is not from an ancient fight, although it looks like. Sometimes the enemy is too small to be visible and just chops off some part of your revenue. And it's very hard to notice, especially if you're a telecom provider. So the business competition, as you have probably faced and seen, is very steep and very difficult. And then we have this guy here, you probably know from the physics classes, it's Lord Kelvin, who has said that if you cannot measure something, then you cannot improve it. You cannot govern it, you cannot manage it. And as you know from the engineering schools that you go, measurement is the beginning of engineering, okay? So how can we measure competition then, okay? And there are many business metrics to track competition, and one of them is the so-called subscriber market share. Allow me to use this two-letter acronym, MS. And the slide wants to continue, okay. So the MS, the market share, is simply the percentage of customers that you own. And the questions that a business person might have, or organization, is, okay, how to define it, how to collect data to compute it, how to present and understand it, and how to analyze it. So this book here symbolizes the story slides that I'm going to give you that will take you through the journey of answering those questions through the help of analytics, big data, and all these business buzzwords that you're probably sick and tired of listening to. So the little heart down there, here, represents things that you need to love in order to get to be good in analytics. So modeling is one of them. And you need to model the market share, and in particular, you will discover that as you approach complicated business metrics, you have to be like the Eskimos, which have 20 words for snow. You know, if you live in snow, you have to invent, if you cannot find, words to describe various conditions of the snow. So it is the case here. There are many definitions of market share. Each one has different properties, okay? So the domestic market share, for example, has to do with the Greek nationals, let's say, whereas the Romans market share has to do with visitors like you. You have to turn on your phone, and then the carrier has the highest signal has taken you, okay? And that's one notion of competition, okay? Who wins? The guy that has the strongest signal, for example. And the MS is simply the ratio between my active domestic customers and all active domestic customers. Okay, and let's move on, if this wants to do it. Okay. Well, you know, a lot of us, young, it's not only a characteristic of young people, but also senior people like myself, you always Google things, right? So why don't I go to Google and Google the answer? And if I go to this ad.gr, which is the independent agency that counts the number of lines, you're gonna get the so-called declared registered customers of each provider. I'll do the math and I'm done. Well, but that's declared. If my grandmother has a phone who's never used, it will count as a line. Okay? It will give me false indication of market share. Okay, so things are not that simple. In fact, Einstein said things should be simple but not simpler. Things have complexity. Therefore, I cannot just Google it, okay? Although it's a good idea to start with it. Oh boy, look at this. The punishment of Keynote. So how about using my own data, okay? then there is something, please don't look at the slide, something, a data set that all the telecom providers actually use, which is called call detail. And the call detail is a detail list of who calls what. Who calls who and what, of course, if it is, let's say, a service, and who is called by. And that's the primary data source that someone could use to compute the market share. Okay? Of course, other data would be useful, such as demographic data, social network data, credit cards, any other data that could enhance our knowledge of the market share. But for simplicity of presentation, I'm going to leave it out. Okay. So suppose that we are company A, us, and company B, them. What I hope to see when I look at the data, because of course I own this data which is on this side, I know subscriber A being called by subscriber B or calling subscriber B, okay? And the call detail will be a table like this, the time of the call, who calls who, and whether or not A or B belongs to company A. And what I hope to happen there is that with a little bit of help of statistics, here it is, it's a Greek word, statistics, it's the key. I hope that by looking at the data, I will discover the population of company B by simply looking at my own data. I hope that this algorithm is going to converge into discovering that A and B are actually, B is one of the customers of the foreign company, of the competitor. Therefore, I can find out who they are and how many they are, and of course, how much volume of calls do they make. And of course, there are questions like, will all the customers of B ever be seen? Are there customers that are hidden from me in this? Again, I'm going to leave it out for simplicity. So, using my own data, what it means is to use the call detail data. Okay, and if you do simple math there, then what you get is some 10 to the third calls per day that are made by this 11 million Greek domestic subscribers, and therefore, is that the big data? Okay. You hear the word big data, or what is big data after all? Okay, I'm going to try to prove you that this is big data, because if you do further math, then you're going to get a tsunami of data. That's the picture of the tsunami of the data that today's companies are faced with. As you are sitting here in the audience, Apple, Microsoft, and Google and others are recording what you're doing. They're recording the steps as I do them right now. Therefore, there's a lot of data out there. And yes, they could become a tsunami. And the metaphor goes as far as becoming powerless to analyze the data, and that's the meaning of the flood here, okay? So if I had to read this data out of an SSD disk, I would take about 142 hours. Now you may dispute this math, you may have faster disks, parallel disks, but the heart of the matter is you need that, okay? And you need to collect data continuously, volume, and what you do with it is actually you store it in some analytics database. There's no other way to process the data than putting in some analytics database. And you also need a lot of CPU time to perform any computations, okay? If you spend 10 instructions per byte, then you will need 142 hours processing, as many hours as you need to read the data out of an SSD, okay? So that's big data, okay? If I need to process this volume of calls from 1 year of Greek call detail, then I'll need that much, just to read it once, okay, and process it. And that's one of the reasons people talk about big data and they require a lot of resources to do things. The total bill would be 142 hours to read the data, 142 CPU hours to process the data, and maybe 1/10 of it to write the data back, okay? And analytics professionals are continuously into this job of reading data, analyzing the data, writing the results. Okay? That's how we spend our time, our lives, and also analyzing it. So, leaving the story a little bit, as you know, the big data is actually characterized better by volume, variety, and velocity. In fact, the industry has added another three V's, but volume means the sheer volume of the size, the number of instances, the number of calls in our case. The variety is to what extent I see a lot of variation in this data, because otherwise it may not be very useful. And of course, the velocity has to do with the input rate that this data is generated, because trust me, in the industry, you almost never study static data sets. Once you discover the market share computation, you would like to deploy it to be computed daily, incrementally, okay? And therefore, the three V's are important. Those are actually the justification for big data. Of course, it depends on the problem that you have. There are problems that do not require big data, and they run, let's say, on a Raspberry Pi or on your laptop. But in general, the problems you have to deal with are problems that require a lot of resources. So let's say I did that, and I'm company A, and I get this famous 33%. It's actually very nice, because in Greece you have three providers, so let's say the market share is 33%. Now what? Okay, I gave to my customer this number, and I put it in the big letters, and this is not a mistake of keynote, just to drive the point across that this number, although it's big, is nothing. Why? Because it's just a number. And as you know from the Eskimos, this market share is more complicated than it looks like. Things should be simple, but not simpler. Now what? Okay, let's go on to the rest of the job, the next steps of the process. How do I present this data, and how I get to understand it? Okay, and sometimes I call our job in analytics also data cooking, because like cooking, we have to prepare the data, make them in a presentable form, in a consumable form, and the best way to consume the data is through visualization. So now I did all the hard work to collect the data, to analyze it. Now let's try to present it. And you know, no presentation is interesting if it doesn't involve a map. So here's a map of Greece, this hypothetical market share by major geographical areas. And now I begin to understand that the 33% is a kind of misleading number, because it's not uniform across the country as you would expect. This area down there, which has dark red color, I think, this area there, seems to have, you know, one of the lowest market share for company A. Therefore, it's probably an area that I have to look for. But this is the problem, it's not the impact. The impact has to do with the business cost of having low market share there. So sometimes you use visualization many times to actually show the impact and the problem, and then get an action out of it, okay? And furthermore, if I drill down and if I see things, that's where visualization and statistics now go together, and that's why sometimes they call them visual analytics. I can employ some statistical theory to explain that really what's going on here is a statistical process where we have, let's say, an area here. This is actually Athens, this area. And the distribution of the market share value across different zip codes is not uniform. Therefore, there may be opportunities for improvement within those areas. And this is something very powerful in visual analytics, which is called drill down. So now I collected the data, I got the microscope, which is the visualization system, and I'm looking inside the data to find interesting patterns. And that's the role of analytics, of visual analytics, in understanding the market share. Okay. So far, so good. Okay. If you have any questions, you have to, unfortunately, reach me at the end of the talk. So Lord Kelvin said, OK, if you measure something, then you can improve it. And the question is, how do you improve something that you have measured? How do you improve the market share in you know, my home island of Karpathos, which a company A is not doing very well? Okay, and then we get to other steps, okay? Again, the revenge, all right. So the difference from the baseline. One of the key things we do in understanding the data is to establish baselines, okay? To establish how things should be. What's normal, okay? What is a normal market share? Well, a very gross market share here is shown as this dotted line, here it is, which shows the national average. So with respect to this national average, those areas are below, okay? Some areas are higher, so those are definitely below. Therefore, I I can pick up outliers, as they call, exceptions, which are probably candidates for immediate improvement, okay? All right, somebody wants to know about the market share. All right, so let's move on. So the visual analytics, as you can imagine, is like a microscope which a microbiologist or actually a data analyst has to look continuously to find patterns. And this analysis, although it's very powerful by today's standards, it's still, as I call it, you actually do many miles with the mouse, okay? You keep moving the mouse, you click and you discover things as you do with the microscope, of course, or the telescope. Can you algorithmize that process? Can you automate the process? And that's where the algorithmic analytics come in place. Okay, that's where years of research and mathematics work in statistics have actually paid off, and also algorithms, which allow you to automate this analysis. And it's only limited by computer resources, but also by the time and skill of the data scientist. The data scientist has to monitor, has to supervise the algorithms in order to get any results. Otherwise, garbage in, garbage out, as you probably have heard in your studies. Okay? So many times, people can go as far as the visual analytics, but when it comes to the analytics puzzle, are really puzzled, okay? They find different algorithms that are presented by different colors that's supposed to converge to the target, but you are in 0% of progress because you just don't know what to do. You apply, you try, and that's where you need some deeper knowledge of analysis in order to get to the target, okay? And that's the part of analytics which is actually human intensive, and that's actually also the most interesting one, okay? So to give you some very simple examples, let's say I'm trying to understand the market share across some geography, age groups, and incomes. Then I can deploy the decision tree clustering, which will take the entire population up there and say that a certain percentage, it's urban subscribers, rural subscribers are here, and then young and medium age group, low income, high income. That way you get a very different representation of the geographical one, thanks to decision tree clustering and descriptive analytics. And yes, you can click your way out, trying to find the same examples, the same conclusions, but here you have it in your plate, and you know that low-income, young, urban customers have, for example, low market share, below the baseline. And high-income, young, urban customers have high market share, etc. Okay? So you get more clever with the data in order to do that. The next level, okay, is the predictive analytics, in which case, having the data, it would be nice to know what's going to happen in the summertime when perhaps the people will move to other areas of the country in which they do holidays, and are they going to continue to be with me, company A? And then I can use algorithms such as random forests, for example, which will tell you things like the average market share is likely to decrease across the country, so something is wrong with your company, and the average market share is likely to increase in median income, median age subscribers, for example. That's another conclusion that can help you take an action. And in order to do that, you have to use your data as a basis to predict other things. And you may find the prediction in this problem trivial, but it isn't, because as you know, the telecom traffic varies with time and varies with personal and other situations. For example, when new students enter university, all suddenly their telecom needs increase. Therefore, the line market share may not change that much, but the volume share is going to change. So the predictive analytics algorithms will actually automatically take care of it and give you some reasonable prediction in which you can base your marketing campaigns. Okay. So in general, our customers, and you probably have seen this in the internet or elsewhere, they have to process a lot of data which are at the bottom of the pyramid, okay? Lots of data, terabytes of data. From that, you have to extract information, ultimately knowledge, and then make decisions out of it. Another way to see it is as the so-called wedding cake, in which the diameter of the cake decreases as you go up, because the volume of the data decreases and the value of the data increases. Okay? And the best thing is at the top. Okay? And our job as analysts is to produce wedding cakes for the customers, which are tasty, they're interesting, and they ultimately lead to good decisions. Okay? And it's our mission, your mission as professionals, our mission as performance, to supply customers, to support, assist and support customers in this journey. Okay? So having said that, how do we do it? Because you're engineers, and we'd like to know, how do you do that? Okay? And you probably, if you had some elementary introduction to analytics, you have seen this picture. It should not come as a surprise to you, but let me outline it. First, you have to collect the data. Okay? Then you have to curate the data. Data are noisy sometimes, very noisy, and usually they're not understandable. And then there is my favorite world, modeling. You know, this world is very complicated. And for the purposes of analysis, you don't need all this detail. You have to be creative, inventive, to represent objects with a minimal number of attributes that can help you address the complexity that comes down the road. Now, the visual analytics is your guide throughout this career, this journey. You visualize the data as you collect them, as you curate them, and as you model them to make sure that you do that correctly. And then there's explorative analysis, the descriptive analytics, and the predictive analytics, which help you then produce the upper parts of the layer cake. And then you still use visual analytics because there's no other way actually to understand those volumes of data. Some people may be nostalgic to Excel tables and the simple graphics that people produce out of it, but in today's world, you need far more sophisticated ways to understand the data, and visual analysis is one of them. How are we doing in terms of time, okay?
We are already going late, so...
You are not looking at your watches or your smartphone, right? So I hope I can continue a few more slides, and then I will end. I saw sometimes this picture and say that if complexity or the problems inside this fortress, those are the tools that can help us penetrate the fortress. But you know, those tools need sophisticated operators, sophisticated engineers to do it. Sometimes I say that what the platforms we have out there are, and I'm not the only one that says that, are very sophisticated. Take, for example, the IBM Watson, or even the Python SK Learn Library. It requires sufficient skill, imagination, hard work, persistence, and responsibility to get the result done. Perhaps we're not trying to conquer the fortress, we're trying to conquer the complexity, but I want you to remember that picture when you do analytics. Okay? And furthermore, as you know from your already from your experience, the academic experience, there are too many tools out there. Okay? There are right tools. I'm sorry, this was also a marketing slide, so I'm not trying to sell you anything that performance does, but nevertheless, I'm trying to say that out of the plethora, out of the proliferation of tools and systems that are out there, you need to select a few and become the best out of it and combine them to create the analytics pipeline in order to make your customer, your employer, you know, utilize the results, the fruits of analytics. Okay? And performance is trying to do that. So that's what the company I work with. I'm head of analytics and performance technologies. We have selected a few tools, which I'll present you later, that do those things. Okay? And all of these bullets there, support, educate, design, select, with a different order, is things we do, okay? And finally, so to be a bit specific, we use this abstract architecture to do it, which, if you want to see which products are related to it, then it's the next slide, which is also, so we collect data from this part, okay, from various databases. We put them in Vertica. Vertica is a state-of-the-art analytics database. We use Tableau to visualize it, and then a lot of custom machine learning code, which also fed to Tableau for further analysis, okay? And underneath, there is machinery using Docker, Cloudera, VMware to provide the resources for it, okay? So you need to get to know the tools, okay? Use them correctly in the business context, and you need to develop those skills in order to go to the marketplace. And those tools may be different depending on which customer, which country you are, but nevertheless, it will be a database, visualization system, and algorithmic system. And the jobs and the skills that are out there, you know probably already, SQL is actually something very powerful in order to analyze and process data. Machine learning analytics, Python is the king, Vertica is another king, also there are other languages, we don't use them very much. For visualization, we use Tableau and Python notebooks, some end-user systems, and of course for software development, which there's quite a bit of it, Python and Java. Those are the things, the basic things that you need to know in order to play the analytics game, in order to ride the analytics wars, okay? And here I am, you know, trying to deal with unresponsive computer, okay? And I would like to thank you very much for your time. Remember that you are a fighter pilot, okay? You operate sophisticated analytical machines, and you need to be very good at it in order to succeed. Thank you very much.